was probably when I converted to the Catholic Church when I was in high school. I immediately had the opportunity to attend the March for Life in D.C. And at the time, it was like, oh, here's this like, fun trip. Being pro-life sounds pretty cool. Sure, yeah, let's do it. And I had a pretty naive perspective. It was just, I was pro-life because the procedure, as it was described, seemed very brutal and horrible. But when I was actually there, there's a lot going on in D.C. during the March for Life, if anyone's been there. And there is a whole section that has these massive images of aborted fetuses, and I didn't see it coming, and it was just kind of something I turned, and I saw, and it definitely achieved the shock factor that was intended, and it was very unsettling. But for the first time, I felt as though I really didn't understand what abortion was. And at that point forward, I dedicated myself to stopping it and trying to increase awareness. And as time went on, I read up, I talked to people about it, and I felt as though I really matured in my stance on the pro-life issue, and I really developed a diverse and compassionate view. And while it's happened to me, that's also happened to the country. Since 1973, when abortion was legalized, our society's perspective of it has changed. Because initially, people believed, it was the popular opinion, that what was removed during abortion was a clump of cells or a blob of tissue. I mean, you all heard that. People tried to call it anything that would strip away all implied humanity. It was just this entity. People aren't saying that anymore. If you notice, and if you are hearing people say that, know that they are way behind even the modern pro-choice stance on the matter, because science is far beyond that, and people know that they really are ignorant, and they're saying that to this point. And so because we have sonograms and we can see what a fetus looks like, and people can't claim that anymore, pro-choice side realized that they had to shift their argument a little bit and start saying, oh, well, yeah, we know that this is bad, but we're going to make it safe, legal, and rare, and abortion is a necessary evil. However, they can't even really say that anymore, figuring that countless doctors have signed petitions saying that abortion is never medically necessary to save the life of a mother. And so that's something that a lot of pro-life people don't understand, and that any procedure that occurs to save a woman's life, that in the process ends the life of the fetus, is considered an abortion. And so we need to correct people if they get that wrong. So now that that one's out of the way, people are trying to find new reasons to be pro-choice, because every time we prove them wrong, we're like, oh no, we need to change our perspective on this issue. And I think the only explanation for this is moral relativism, which is a huge problem in our society right now, and I know it's kind of a hot topic. And if you're not familiar with what that means, it's basically the perspective that, oh, well, your truth is your truth, my truth is my truth, no one's right or wrong, you can do whatever you want. And the issue is that, obviously, people believing that about anything leads them away from the truth, and it creates this separation and this wall between them and Christ. But also, with the issue of abortion, it's not just them that's being affected, it is the unborn child. And so that's something that we need to address even harder, and we really need to be fighting against that. So while this is discouraging, it should be noted that we're winning, and the pro-choice side is admitting that, and they're admitting that they're scared. And this can be proven with just the very fact that when I was a senior in high school, Mizzou took four people to the pro-life march. Mizzou students' lives, I'm referring to. My freshman year, we took five. Last year, we took six. And this year, we're taking 18. And it's the same club. We've just grown so much. And it's just undeniable that people are becoming more and more aware that this is an issue that we need to stop. And it's worthy of our time. Mizzou had no choice really but to give us the most improved campus organization award last year. And that's because we've grown so much in membership, because people are realizing the importance that we put our energy and our time into this. And our generation is the pro-life generation, and that is so encouraging. But the issue is that abortion, as it is going along day to day, is allowing us to ignore the true problems that we're having in our society. Society wants to tell us that an unplanned pregnancy is the worst thing that could ever happen to us. And our culture wants to believe that if a college student were to become pregnant, then there's no way that she could ever achieve her dreams in life or finish her education if she were to carry through the pregnancy and choose another child. And I think that that's incredibly insulting and backwards thinking. And in the most pro-women's rights generation thus far, the fact that we're falling to the mind that abortion somehow is liberating us is very sad. Abortion can be viewed oftentimes as the quick, neat, easy way out. However, that's not really true except for men and people that want to put women in an even further bad place, like if it's a bad relationship or abusive parents or anything in between. And so I'm also confused as to why the pro-choice side isn't bothered by the fact, or they don't even take note of the fact that the Supreme Court that decided Roe versus Wade was comprised entirely of men. And yet they try to claim that pro-choice people are all old white men. And so I think that there's a lot of hypocrisy in that, and we really need to bring that to light. So, you know, I see men with this issue, and I think it's so sad that they're oftentimes pushed out. But within my community, these men are demonstrating genuine care and compassion while supporting life-affirming views. I see men volunteering at the My Life Clinic and helping women through these crisis pregnancy situations. Together, male and female believers in Jesus Christ, we know the truth. And we know that we're all called upon to love everyone as God does. Therefore, when we see a crisis pregnancy, why are we not so focused on addressing the crisis? Instead, we're letting society continue to feed the lie that, no, if you eliminate the pregnancy, the whole problem will be gone. But as Catholics, we need to say, like, what is making this a crisis pregnancy? Because pregnancy in itself is a very natural occurrence. There's something else going on that we need to talk about. Like I said, are the parents going to hurt the daughter if she doesn't follow through the procedure? Is the boyfriend bad? Does she not have enough money? Does she have enough resources? Why aren't we talking about those things? Because if we can solve those problems, then the pregnancy isn't an issue. But if we eliminate the pregnancy, then this bad situation is going to keep going on. And that's why I'm so glad as Catholics that we really are taking note, and like I said, volunteering at the My Life Clinic, and our church is having a diaper drive for women in these situations. And that's so great that we are recognizing that and addressing it. So, as Catholics, we're all called to love. And this means offering our time and talents to make sure that women get what they need. And this means never backing away from the opportunity to defend life. So on a different note, as president of Students for Life, I'm oftentimes called and asked to defend the pro-life stance from a non-religious perspective. And I don't find this to be a challenge by any means, because there's so much science behind this. And my dad, who is an atheist, who his political stances are all across the board, he is just as pro-life as I am. And he, like, truly just gets upset thinking about it. situation in their life. And that's what it really comes down to, like I said. And so if we really have faith and we really trust in God, then the act of exterminating that right to life and the miracle that God has created would really have to be a word from the devil. And we can't sugarcoat that at all. And our very own Father Joseph would agree. And him and I had some wonderful conversations about that. He is very wise. A couple of different times I've had the privilege of witnessing to be unborn with him, whether it be outside of a clinic or just at some kind of event. And at one point we were talking about abortion and how there's such a strong battle over the hearts and minds of young people of our generation about this issue. And we were reflecting on a time when we were praying outside of Planned Parenthood, and this group called, I believe, the Silly Hughes came and were counter protesting us. And that's not the name that we gave them, that's the name that they call themselves. And they dressed as female reproductive genitalia and literally just served to try to mock and belittle and scare away the pro-life people there praying for what's happening inside the clinic. And what Father Joseph said that really resonated with me is that the devil shows up when really holy things are happening. We don't see this kind of extreme opposition to any other social issue. And that's how we know that the devil is scared. And that's reaffirming the importance of what we're doing by protecting God's children, our very own brothers and sisters in Christ. So what I found in conclusion is that as a culture, we are so afraid of being wrong. And we don't want to believe that, you know, maybe in the past we sat by quietly endorsed